नमस्कार फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू सेशन 52 इन अवर कोर्स ऑन ऑपरेशंस मैनेजमेंट एंड करंटली वी आर इन द 11th वीक ऑफ अवर डिस्कशन एंड द टॉपिक ऑफ 11th वीक इज मटेरियल्स मैनेजमेंट एंड इफ यू रिमेंबर इन द प्रीवियस सेशन वी हैव जस्ट डिस्कस्ड द बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ मटेरियल्स मैनेजमेंट. वी हैव सीन व्हाट आर द ऑब्जेक्टिव्स ऑफ मटेरियल्स मैनेजमेंट, व्हाट इज द स्कोप ऑफ मटेरियल्स मैनेजमेंट, व्हाट आर द रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटीज ऑफ अ मटेरियल्स मैनेजर. And we have tried to define the word inventory, which is most commonly used in materials management. In nutshell, we have tried to find out that what materials management is all about and what we need to do in order to ensure efficient and effective utilization of our materials. So we have seen that there are three important aspects of materials management, starting from the procurement of materials, then ensuring the proper usage of materials, and finally the accounting of the materials that have been procured. So procurement, usage and accounting are the three keywords that are related to materials management. And today we are going to focus on inventory control, which is a slightly specific topic. Materials management is more general in nature and inventory is more specific in nature. In the last session, towards the end, last two slides were focused on defining the term inventory, and we have also seen that what type of materials make up the inventory. So we have seen the raw materials, the work in process, the parts that are being transported from one place to the another place within the organization, the tools and equipment all fall under the inventory. And it is important for us to manage our inventory properly. If we are not able to manage the inventory properly, we may have to suffer huge losses in the organization. So today we will see that how we can manage our inventory, and the topic for today is inventory control. So prior to that, let us try to highlight the importance of inventory control, that why do we need to keep an inventory. Some of you can question this, and that is a very valid question, that why not to procure the material when it is required. So we need not keep an inventory, we need not tie up our capital in the inventory, that is that we need not spend money and keep the inventory in stock. So why do we need to keep an inventory? Why these materials at the first instance are required in the industry? So our next slide will answer all these queries, that what is so important that we need to keep the inventory. Now the first thing that explains that is the bullwhip effect. The inventory and supply chain management are interrelated things, and inventory is one of the important elements of supply chain management. So first is the bullwhip effect, which means that the demand information is distorted as it moves away from the end use customer. Now as an end use customer, suppose I want to buy a mobile phone of a particular company, so that is the demand at my end, so that I am the end use customer of that mobile phone. But as I move down to the company, the complete chain of people who are involved in this chain will maybe the information may get distorted, so the complete information may not be there. Some companies are making use of the direct interface these days between the customer and the company. Directly you can order online to the company, and they can have a better idea that what is the exact demand of our product in the market. So these days the use of information technology is helping the companies to reduce this effect, but many times the demand gets distorted because of the bullwhip effect. Higher safety stock inventories are stored to compensate this. So there is another word is coming here, safety stock. So we will try to understand this when we go through our discussion on economic order quantity, that what do we mean by the safety stock. But in order to compensate for this effect, many times the company keep a safety stock of materials, that whenever required we can get this material from the safety stock. Otherwise they may have a particular service level of materials, that this is is my normal maybe working capital, and if in case of emergency I will draw the capital from this safety stock that I have maintained. Normally we do in our management of our finances, mostly we will keep some amount as a working capital for daily expenditure, and the other amount we will keep as a safety stock, that if required then only I will use this safety stock, otherwise I will manage by my day-to-day expenditure money that I have kept. Similarly for materials also, for normal usage of the materials that are required in assembly operation or in the manufacturing process, we will keep certain level, but we will keep another level down, that will be the safety stock. Whenever required we will take the material from the safety stock. So mostly companies keep a safety stock so that the process must not stop, because in many industries, for example, if you are making electricity from coal, in especially in case of thermal power generation, you cannot afford to stop the boilers because refiring may take a huge amount of investment. In many other processes also which are capital intensive, you will not wish to stop the process in want of materials, therefore you will always keep certain materials in store so that the process is not stopped and is process is continuous. Many times there will be seasonal or cyclic demand, so we have to keep the inventory in order to meet that demand. Inventory provides independence from the vendors. We precisely will not be required to look up to the vendors every now and then whenever there is a requirement, because if we have certain material or maybe certain amount of material in the inventory, we can very easily use that material instead of depending upon the vendors every now and then. So that is also one important requirement, that why we must keep an inventory and why we must manage our inventory properly. Then sometimes it so happens, as I have already told in the previous session also, there are discounts available. You buy two materials, you get two free, and many times if you buy beyond a particular volume, maybe if you buy more than 100 kg of raw material, you will get this discount. So many times the company want to take advantage of that quantity discounts, and therefore they buy the material in bulk and store it in the form of inventory. And inventory also provides independent between the stages and avoids work stoppages. So which I have already explained, that the inventory is majorly focused on managing the line or the manufacturing line or manufacturing process efficiently and effectively, as well as to ensure the continuous production of the products, and therefore we need to keep an inventory. So with this slide, the major focus to emphasize is that why do we need to keep the materials in the store? In our house also, we will not, maybe every now and then, we will not be running to the grocery store to buy our materials. We may, maybe for a month, we may buy our grocery and keep it in our kitchen cabinet or in the store adjoining the kitchen, so that for the complete month, we have stocked our rations properly. Similarly, in case of industry, there also the manufacturing is going on, so we will buy the material and keep it in the store so that the process is continuous. And whenever the level or the quantity of materials go beyond or go below a particular level, we will reorder the materials so that our stocks or our stores are replenished by the materials. So that is what is basically inventory management and control. So we will see that one of the important topics today, that how we can control our materials. So inventory control is very, very important, because we need to find answers to certain questions. So inventory control is a planned approach for determining. So we need to find out answers when we are managing our inventory, that what to order, that is one thing. When to order, that is in the time domain, maybe every fortnight, every month, or every 3 months, or every 6 months, or every year, whatever is our time window, that we have to decide. First is what we have to order, when we have to order, then the third question is how much to order. Whether we must buy the materials required for next 1 year at one go, or we may break it into two orders of 6 months each, or we may break that or may divide that order into 4 orders every quarter. So we have to take a decision what to order, when to order, how much to order, and how much to stock. That is the safety stock, that how much safety stock we must keep in order to avoid any discontinuity in our manufacturing process. So these answers we have to look for in our topic of inventory management and control. The costs associated with buying and storing are optimal without interrupting production and sales. Now, all these answers we have to find out subject to the cost associated with buying and storing is optimal without interrupting the production and sales. Again, I have read the sentence for all of you, that answers to these questions we have to find out either mathematically or intuitively or by our experience. But what must be always kept in mind, that the cost involved in answering all these questions or finding solutions to all these cost questions must not be very high. At the same time, we have to ensure that the process or the manufacturing process must not stop. The assembly of our cars or assembly of our automobiles must not stop. So that is also very, very important. Now, inventory control basically deals with two problems. The first problem is, when should an order be placed and how much should be ordered? So order quantity. So the answer to the second question first is the economic order quantity model. Usually we term it as a EOQ model, and we will cover the EOQ model in our next session. In many competitive exams also, in many, you can say, university exams, there are numerical problems, quantitative problems related to the economic order quantity, and it is an important topic not only from the academic point of view but also from the application point of view, from the industry point of view. We must know that what is the economic order quantity. Using our simple mathematical formula, we can do the calculation for EOQ. And the first answer to the first question is, when should an order be placed? That is the order level. So that we will see. Usually we term it as a reorder point or reorder level also, that when should an order be placed, that is how much is left in our stock when we must place the order. That will depend upon the lead time also, that after placing an order, what is the gap of time by which we will receive our order. So we have to see what is the lead time, what is our consumption rate. Based on these two parameters, the consumption rate, that is how the material is getting consumed over a period of time. Today if we order, after how many days or how many weeks we will get our order. So these two things will decide that what is going to be our reorder level. We will try to understand this with the help of a diagram also. So first of all, we have to learn that what is inventory control and how to find the answers to all these questions. So selective control of inventory, that is one what we can refer now. Selective control refers to the variation in method of control from item to item on selective basis. So from part or component to component wise, we have to exercise different type of control. So selective control refers to a variation in method of control from item to item on selective basis. So in this system, the items are categorized in a few groups depending upon the selective criteria, such as value, usage, frequency, and consumption. Such grouping helps the organization for scientific inventory control. So we have to manage the materials in our organization, and we have to frame a criteria to classify these materials so that we focus on the materials which are important and put less focus on the materials which are less important. Although all materials are important in the industry, but a relative grading can be worked out on the high value materials as well as on a low value material. So we can classify the materials, and that one of the methods for this classification is the ABC classification. So we will see one problem related to ABC classification today, but there can be other methods of classification based on the usage, based on the value of the products or value of the parts that we are focusing our attention on, or value of the materials that are in our inventory. So we may have 15 different types of materials in our inventory, and we wish to classify them into 5 different categories. So that classification can be based on the usage of those materials. For example, one material is used very frequently, every day maybe 10 ton of that material is required. Other material may be required in a very less quantity, maybe 1% of this high valued or high volume material. One material is required maybe 10 tons per day, other may be required as 10 kgs per day. So based on the usage, we can classify one material high volume material, another is low volume, only 10 kgs required per day, that is based on usage. Another one can be based on the value of the material, another can be the frequency of usage. Some materials may be very frequently used, some materials may be less frequently used. For example, if we go to a shopping mall, so there will be a high frequency material which is like kind of vegetable or maybe daily grocery things. Then there can be high valued materials in the shopping mall, for example the LED TVs or maybe refrigerators or air conditioners. So the sales frequency may be less for high valued material, but sales frequency is more for the low valued materials like vegetable or maybe the grocery items. And then the consumption may be another criteria for classifying the material. So we can classify the materials based on usage, value, frequency, consumption. So there can be different criteria. Now, such grouping, why do we need to group the materials? Because we as managers, as engineers, we have to focus on specific group of materials. So we, whatever is our objective, whatever is our maybe the target, we have to classify them so that we are able to achieve our target. In many cases, we may not like to focus on a material which is not very costly. So based on the value, we can classify that this material is not very costly. Even if we focus our attention on this material, we are not going to gain much. So where we must focus? We must focus on high valued material, because even if we are able to save some amount of money in this high valued material, we will be able to save substantial money for our organization. So similarly, that maybe focus area can be identified by classifying the material. So I think I have tried to highlight the importance of classifying the materials, and now let us take an example of various types of analysis. So we will take two today, that is ABC analysis and the VED analysis, that is vital, essential and desirable. And there can be HML also, high, medium and low analysis. As I have already told, the criteria can be the usage, the value, the consumption, the frequency. There can be different criteria for classifying the materials. One of them is ABC that we are going to understand today with the help of a diagram and an example, and we will try to understand the very basic concept of VED analysis also. So ABC classification you can see on your screen now. The classification on the basis of cost and volume. So we can see here the usage is also taken into account and the value is also taken into account. So the cost is maybe corresponding to the value of that particular material, and the volume can be the usage of that particular material. Now we will classify, as the name goes, ABC classification. We will classify the materials as class A material, class B material and class C. Now let us see what is class A. Now class A material is that it will be only 5 to 15% of the units. Now suppose we have 10 different types of materials, so we will have either one or two materials only which will fall in class A, but their overall value will be around 75 to 80% or 70 to 80% of the value. So these will be costly items. The number of items will be less, but their value will be more. Similarly, class B, maybe 20 to 30% of the items will fall in class B. That is, if we have 10 different types of materials, we can have 2 to 3 items or materials which can fall in class B, and the value of these materials will be 15 to 20% only. And the last is class C items, which are maybe cheaper items, the value is very less, but their numbers may be more. For example, if we see in an office, we may have computers, we may have 3 computers only, the number is less, but the value is more. But the stationary items, for example, the pencils, pen stands and the other resistors, etc., so their number is more, but the value is less. So if we classify the materials that are there in an office, so the computers will have maybe high value, but the number is less. But the stationery, on the other hand, the number of stationery items is more, but the value associated with these items is less. So we classify the material as A, B and C as given on your slide. Similarly, we can try to understand this with the help of this diagram. So class C items, you can see the percentage of inventory items out of 10, as we have taken an example, maybe 6 items are class C items, but their overall value is approximately 5 to 10% only. Class B, here we have maybe 30% of the item out of 10, 3 items are maybe class B items, but their value is maybe 15 to 20%. But there is maybe 1 item out of 10 which is class A item, and the value of that item is 80%. So this is the way we can classify them as A, B and C. So A items are high value items, 70 to 80% of the value is associated with them, but their number is less. And on the contrary, class C items, their value is less, they may account for 5 to 10% of the overall value, but they are high number, the number is large, so that is more percentage of the units in class C item. So let us take a very quick example. So this is one example, how do we do the calculations for classifying the material as A, B and C. So this is annual usage is given. The part numbers are given, there are 10 different items here, part 1, part 2 to part 10. Unit cost for each item is given, or each part is given. So what we can do, we can multiply this to establish the overall value, that which item is having the maximum value and which item is having the lower value. And consumption is already given to us, so we can do the calculation further. So first we will arrange this based on the total value, because our one criteria for classifying under ABC is the total value associated with the product. So here we can see item number 9, $30,600. So you can see item number 9 here, 510 multiplied by 60. So when we multiply this, we will get this value, 30,600. Similarly, when we multiply the usage and the cost, we will get the total value. So we have unit cost also available, annual usage also available. So based on these two data point data and the multiplication of these values, we will get the total value, and then we can calculate the total value is coming out to be $85,400, and then we can calculate how much is this contributing in the total value. So the percentage contribution of this can be calculated by dividing this by the total value. So 30,600 divided by 85,400, we will get maybe 35.9%. So value that we will get is 0.359 multiplied by 100, we will get 35.9% contribution of part 9 towards the total value. Similarly, part 7 is contributing only 2% to the total value. So the total value, 35% contribution is coming from part 9. Similarly, percentage of total quantity also we can calculate. We know that the total usage, annual usage, is available with us for each and every part. From there we can calculate what is the percentage of total quantity for part number 9. So part number 9, we can see in the previous slide, part number 9 only 60 items are used per maybe year, because this is the annual usage given to us, 60 parts only per year for part number 9. So if we add this, we can calculate the percentage contribution in the total annual usage by part number 9. So we can calculate that, and here we can calculate the percentage cumulative, that what is the cumulative percentage of this maybe part in the overall consumption, and based on that we can classify the material. Now maybe this figure, we have done the calculation, we have multiplied the unit cost with the annual usage, then we have calculated the percentage contribution of a particular part in the total value. We know the annual usage, based on that we have seen what is the percentage contribution of a particular part in the annual usage. So we have found out the percentage contribution of individual part in the total value, we have calculated the contribution of individual part in the total usage or the annual usage. From that we can classify. Now if you remember, A, B and C, A are items which are having high value, 70 to 80% value contribution in the overall value, but their numbers are less, maybe 10 to 15% of the total usage. So we can see, we can classify them as on your screen. You can see A item, high value, low usage, and part C where we see low value, high usage. So maybe here we can see A, B and C. So A, we can, if we add up these three total value percentage contribution, 16 plus 14 comes out to be 30 plus 30, so the total usage can be maybe see more than 60% here. So and the usage is percentage cumulative usage is 15%, so their number of items is less, maybe 3 items only, but their percentage usage is 15%, and the total value is maybe nearly 70%. So usage less, value more, A, usage more, value less, C. So that is what is given here. So items 9, 8 and 2 are classified as A because their percentage of total value is more and their percentage of total usage is less, or total quantity contribution is less, whereas C items, 4 items are there, their total value is only 12.5%, but the percentage of total quantity you can see is 60%. So this way we can classify. If we have the unit cost available with us for all the parts or the components, we have the annual usage available, we can multiply them, we can calculate the percentage contribution of individual part in the total value of the maybe materials, and then we can calculate the total usage also, percentage contribution of total usage by every component, and then we can classify them. High value will be, high valued components will be given as class A, and low usage on the other hand for class C, we will see the value is less for these materials but the usage is more. So this is one particular classification, that is ABC classification. So advantages of ABC, I'll read this for you. This approach helps the manager to exercise selective control and focus his attention on few items only. So he can focus on high value products or high value components or parts only. By exercising strict control on A class items, the materials manager is able to show the results within a short period of time only. So he can show the gains by exercising control on class A type of items, which are high valued items. It results in reduced clerical cost, saves time and effort, and results in better planning and control of the materials. Now what is the limitation? That it is not a one-time exercise and items are to be reviewed and recategorized periodically. So the usage may keep on changing, the unit cost may also sometime change because of certain discounts or other criteria. So we maybe every year or every 2 years we can recalculate or recategorize the materials as A, B and C category materials or A, B and C class materials. So last part maybe for today, just an introduction, what is VED analysis? Instead of based on the total value or the usage, we can also classify our materials as vital, essential and desirable. So the analysis classify the items into three groups or the materials into three groups, that is vital, essential and desirable. Now just we will try to understand what type of materials will fall under vital category, what type of materials will fall under essential as well as the desirable. Now what are vital items? Vital items are those items whose unavailability will stop the production. So they are the lifeline of the production process. So if you cut the lifeline, the process will stop. So vital items are those items whose unavailability will stop the production. Essential items are those items whose stock out costs are very high. So if we are not able to provide that material, the stock out cost will be very very high. Desirable items will not cause any immediate production stoppages and their stock out costs are minimal or nominal. So based on this also, this classification also, we can classify the materials. So maybe the most important are the vital, because if you don't have a vital or if you have a stock out of the vital materials, the overall production process may stop. So in today's session, we have seen two different methods of classifying the materials in the organization, that is the ABC analysis and the VED analysis. In ABC, we classify the materials as class A, class B and class C. Class A, high value, maybe low usage. On the other hand, class C, low value, high usage. And in vital, essential and desirable, vital components are very important because their unavailability will lead to the stoppage of the production process. Prior to that, we have tried to understand that what is the role of inventory control and more specifically, why do we need to keep an inventory. Now in the next session, we will try to answer our questions like how much to order, that is economic order quantity, and we will try to see that when to put our reorder, what is the lead time, what is the reorder level, all those things we will try to understand in our next session. Thank you.